Hello everyone, this is Matthew Tucker. Welcome to another tutorial in the Bifrost rigging module series. In today's video, we're diving into the setup area of a Bifrost rigging module. In the user setup area of the module, this would be considered the construction area. You define all your joints, controls, and attributes, assign them names and transforms, and connect them to the rest of your rig. Let's navigate to the user setup area now. Start by going to Windows, Bifrost Graph Editor, and create a new graph. For this lesson, we'll use the template module. And before we get started, let's make it editable so we can change whatever we need to inside the module itself. So we'll do that by right-clicking and do make editable. Now that that's done, let's double-click to dive in. So the area we'll be focused on is this user setup area. I'll double-click in here. And this is the user setup area where we'll be doing all of our work today. As you can see, the template module comes with a great sticky note with how to use this area. But we'll delete this for now and dive into the layout of the setup area. First is the setup inputs. This holds all the information about pins, your parent data, custom settings, and even your module's name. The setup outputs, and specifically the set definitions, is where all the information about your defined joints and controls will be plugged in for the rest of your module to use in the animation area. The user setup inputs lets you expose parameters for your joints, controls, or even custom attributes to the top of your module so that users can adjust the settings on those parameters to best fit their needs. And finally, this area in the middle is where you'll be doing all your work to define your controls, joints, and attributes. Start setting up our module. We'll be using two separate nodes. But first, let's go to Windows, Node Library. Now, under the Rigging tab, you can see there is a module setup area. This is where we'll find a bunch of our nodes. We'll be using two nodes for today. The Define Control, which will help us build controls, and the Define Joint, which will do the same, but for joints. Now, with those two modules added to our scene, let's close our library and get started. For this lesson, let's build a simple FK chain. First things first, let's name our control and joint. Now, I would like to name these after our module, which right now it's named template. But if I ever update the name of our module, I would have to go in here and do that manually. In order for that to be updated dynamically, let's go to the setup inputs and plug the output name into the input name of our control and joint. With that done, if I go to the very top of our module and select it, I can now update the name parameter and my control and joint will be dynamically updated. So for now, let's name this test. Now, if you ever need to go back to where you last were, at the very top of your Bifrost graph editor, it will remember your last location. So if I go back up here and click user setup, I'm now back to where I was. With these controls and joints named, let's give them a suffix. For the control, I'll do underscore control, or CTRL for short. For joint, I'll do underscore JNT. Now with them given suffixes, let's plug their definitions into the set definition output area. That way, the control and joint will be usable by the rest of the module. Now with our control and joint defined, let's start looking at this in the 3D viewer. I'm going to first start by docking my Bifrost graph editor in the 3D viewport, giving ourselves a little bit more space, and going back up to the top of our graph. I'm going to take my test module and plug the inputs into the input compound. That way, everything in the Maya scene can be read into the module, and the outputs into the output module. That way, everything that's done in my module will be displayed within the 3D viewport. With those connected, I'm going to go to the Bifrost rigging menu and click the option box for the Create Rig From Modules. I want to make sure Synced Containers is turned on, because that will let me see my updates live and in real time. And now we can see we have a joint, and if you look hard enough, there's a control right there. And if I was to go to the Outliner, we can see that a Bifrost Rig node has been created for us. And this will contain everything we've made so far, including our test control and our test joint. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the control is a little hard to see. Let's hide our outliner, go back to our user setup, start changing our control. So if I look down to the very bottom, there's a control shape parameter menu. Let's change the control to a circle. Let's make this a little bit bigger for us. And finally, let's change the color to yellow. Perfect. Now that should be a little bit easier for us to work with. Now, if we want to update our rest position for either control or the joint, I can go into their definitions and update its pivot matrix. This is a 4x4 matrix where the position is in the right-hand column. So if I was to take the X attribute and start sliding it, you can see it updating live in Maya, and its new rest position is being displayed. But that might be a little slow. Let me introduce pins. Let's go ahead and make one now. If I go back to the top of my graph and look at the test model, I don't have access to it yet. So let me go ahead and disconnect the inputs by holding down Control Alt Shift and dragging my little scalpel and disconnecting the graph. Now we have access to the pin menu. Let's make a new pin by hitting the little plus icon, naming it test, and seeing there is a new pivot matrix for us to manipulate. Let's make sure that all the scales are normalized. Now with that done, we can reconnect the inputs. Now, a new pin has not been generated. And if you ever run into that, delete the inputs port and reconnect the inputs. So now there is a little locator generated at the very center of our 3D viewer. With our pin created, if I go in and select it, move it around, nothing happens. So let's go ahead and set it up to drive our joint and control rest positions. Let's go back into our user setup area. We can see there is a pins output and the setup inputs compound. Let's take advantage of that by going to Windows, Node Library, and seeing there is two pins we might want to use, find all pins and find pin. Find all pins is for multiple pins and find pin is just for a singular pin. But knowing that, let's close the Node Library and create that node by using the tab menu. So if I hit tab and start typing in find pin and select it, and now that's created for me, which is a much faster way than browsing through the Node Library if you know exactly what you need. Now let's plug the output pins into the input port of our find pin node. So this is going to rely based on string values. So we know the pin is called test, but this can also use commands. And if you're ever curious, you can hold your mouse over the input field and it will give you tips. Plus, if that is not enough, there is an info tab that will tell you all about the node and the options that it provides. So let's change this test to a wildcard since we know there's only one pin to be found. With that found, let's plug the output pivot matrix into our control and our join. Now we can see this pin is defining the pivot rest position for our control and joint in our scene. Now let's say you wanted your test module to be a child of another one. Go back to the top of our graph and create a root module that will be the parent of our test module. So let's hook up the inputs and the outputs to our graph. You see it automatically generated the root module for us. Let's go ahead and clean up the naming. We'll call this root inputs and root outputs. Now with that done, let's take the outputs of the root and plug it into the parents of our test module. Now if I go back to the outliner and look at the controls, the test control is not a child of the root, and that is the same for the joint. Let's set this up in the setup area. Now back at the user setup area, we can see there is a parent joint and a parent control input in both of our control and joint definitions. In order to find the correct joint for those inputs, you're going to go back to the Windows Node Library and see there is a find parent node. Let's drag that into our scene, close this. Let's also minimize the outliner to get a better view. So when creating this, there are two different kind of parents we can find, a control and a joint. So we're going to need one of each. I'm going to hit Control C and Control V in order to duplicate this find parent and switch this one to joint. Now with those set, let's take the parent's output of the setup inputs and plug it into the inputs of our nodes. With that done, it is using the same find logic of our pin. So we could use a wildstar for both find input fields, since we know the root just has one control and one joint. So let's plug those into the appropriate input fields. You can see it automatically updated. Now the test joint is a child of the root joint. But if you notice, there is another search method. It could be by tags. Now, I'm not sure what the root joint and the root control are tagged with. So let's look for that now. So looking at the parent outputs, it's connected to the parent inputs. If I wanted to see all the information that was being sent between those two ports, I can right click on that connection and open in data browser. Now this will give us all our information. So in the parents, we can see there's setup information. That's what we're looking for. And there is setup information for the controls and joints. And we can see there is a tag option. If I was to click view, it will show us an array of all the tags. And since there's only one entry, there's just the single one. Let's look at all the tags for that. So it is tagged with root and it's tagged with anchor. Let's look at the same for the joints. Let's go to tags, the zero, and the same thing, the root and the anchor. So knowing that, I can go back in and look specifically for either the anchor or the root. And the same connection will still be made because it was able to find a joint and a control based off those tags. Now our graph is looking a little sloppy. So let's give ourselves a little bit more space and clean this up a little bit by grouping. So I'm going to remove this little watch point. And first, let's group our parent nodes. I'm going to select both and hit Control G. This will turn this into a compound and preserve the inputs and outputs of both. So let's dive into that compound and see what it's made. So it's a little unorganized. So if I go to display, auto layout selected, or if I hit the L key, it'll lay it out for me. So I know it's using the same parent's output from the setup. So I can actually use both and delete this port. Now let's rename these to correlate with their correct outputs. So this is the control parent definition and the joint parent definition. Now our scene is looking a little bit more organized already, but let's rename this to find parents. And now we've just made our first group. Now let's add a custom attribute to our control. In order to do that, let's go to the node library and drag and drop the define attributes node into our scene. Closing the library, let's bring up our channel box and select our control. So there's no extra attributes yet, but if I connect the output attribute definition to the input attributes of our control, that new attribute is automatically added. Let's rename this to test header. That is now updated, and now we have a new float attribute added to our control. Now there is metadata you could give this attribute, such as a minimum and maximum value. Different enums, you could even lock this attribute if you wanted to. But if you ever want to change the type of attribute that this is, you're going to go to your define attribute node and right click on the value port. Once that's open, you'll see there's four different value types you could choose from: float, boolean, float three, or init. So if I change this to boolean, it will update. Now we see it is a boolean with an on or off attribute. And finally, let's expose some parameters at the very top of our module for users to adjust as they see fit. Earlier, I adjusted the shape settings of our control, but I want that to be available at the very top of our module. So let's look at the control shape settings. Hit the little plus button to see all of them. Let's take our shape input and plug that into the user setup inputs. So this input field will send this up one layer in the Bifrost graph editor. Let's go up one and see that now the shape input field is available in the user setup. Now let's send that up one more into the user setup inputs. Go up to the very top of our graph. And now we see at the very top of our module, there is a new attribute called shape. And if I was to change this, users now have the ability to open the module at the very top and start adjusting parameters. Now it exists outside the grouping. So let's group that real quick. I'm going to click this little pencil icon to open the customization UI. So with that open, I'm going to select the shape, right click, and add to group. So I'm not sure if there's a display group in here, so I'm going to go ahead and make a new one. We'll call this display. With that done, you now see there's a new display group. And if I'm going to add a bunch of parameters for the setup process of this, I'm going to group that display group. So I'm going to right click the display, add to group, new, and now do setup. So now in the setup group, I can add any set of parameters I want for users to adjust as they see fit. And that is a crash course in the user setup section of the Bifrost rigging module. Now you've got all the tools you need to build joints, controls, and attributes that will later be used in the user animations section for all your transformation logic. Thank you very much.